That was the bird, so I'm going to get started. First off, I'm really, really excited to be here. I just want to let you know that I happened to get sick just in time for this talk, so if my voice is off, I'm really sorry. And of course, this is a very momentous year for the American Naturalist. It turns 150 years old. And to celebrate that, the incoming editor-in-chief, Dan Bolnick, posed the following question to the Twitterverse, where all important things happen now, apparently. And he asked, what is the most influential American naturalist paper for your own career? And surprisingly, this only got 44 replies. So I see more than 44 of us here, and I totally encourage you to email Dan and let him know, because I think it would be an awesome list. And when I saw this, I was like, oh, boom, I know the answer. There's two papers that need to be brought up. The first is arguably a modern classic. This is Dan Janzen's 1967 paper, Why Mountain Passes Are Higher in the Tropics. Show of hands, who knows this paper? Definitely, yeah, okay. The other paper is more recent. It was published in 2003 by Ray Huey, Paul Hertz, and Barry Sinervo, and it's a theoretical consideration about how a single behavior can both impel and impede evolution. And these papers are gonna come up later in the talk, and together they have really positively influenced the way that I think about evolution. So, first and foremost, I consider myself an evolutionary ecologist. I'm fascinated and curious about the abiotic and biotic factors that drive diversity, and I usually approach this through the lens of evolutionary physiology. Oh. So as an approach, this is really disconcerting. I gather information about organisms' phenotypes, primarily their physiology and behavior, especially in lizards. I compare that to environmental data, primarily temperature, that I gather at the local and macrogeographic scale. And then I integrate those data in a phylogenetic framework so as to better understand the processes shaping micro and macroevolutionary patterns. And just about everything that I do is couched in the framework of climate change because I'm really curious about how organisms can behaviorally and physiologically adapt to rising temperatures. And what's interesting is that at the end of this century, even under an optimistic scenario, we're looking at a degree and a half increase in temperature. So for lizards, that can range from like slightly beneficial to absolutely devastating. So for the first part of my talk, I'd like to just share some of my research that has been aimed at answering this one question, which is how do the thermal environment and behavior interact to shape patterns of physiological evolution in tropical lizards? To do this, I'm first going to give you some background on Janzen's hypothesis because it really is foundational for everything we're going to talk about. I'm going to extend on Janzen's hypothesis so that we can really focus in on physiological evolution in tropical lineages of lizards. And I'm going to show you some empirical data testing the hypotheses I'm going to present. And hopefully we can come back around and learn something new about a classic idea. Okay, so let's get started. So back in the 1960s, Janzen observed that there was something pretty special about how temperatures distributed across elevation in tropical and temperate mountains. So let's pretend we're in the Dominican Republic, because that's where we're gonna be spending a lot of time today, and we're gonna visit a high and a low elevation site every month for a year. And what Janzen remarked is that those temperatures across seasons would be extremely stable, and importantly, they wouldn't overlap across elevation. The situation's completely different on temperate mountains. There's a lot more thermal variability, and importantly, that variation is shared across elevations. So if you visited a high elevation site in May, those same thermal conditions would be experienced at low elevation in March or April. But he didn't stop there. Janzen's real insight was to predict how that thermal variation would impact patterns of physiological specialization for the organisms inhabiting those environments. So because of that low thermal overlap, we can consider a tropical mountain to be climatically zoned. And if we had four species of lizards, A through D, that experienced temperatures in their habitats from January to December, they would have relatively narrow and non-overlapping thermal environments. As a consequence, Janzen predicted physiological specialization to those habitats. Does this make sense? Everybody's seen this before. totally different situation in temperate mountains. There's a lot more thermal overlap across elevations. So same four species of lizards going from January to December. There's a lot more thermal variation that they experience. Maybe the summers don't get quite as warm at high elevation and the winters don't get quite as cold at low elevation, but overall, they experience a lot of the same thermal conditions. As a result, Janssen predicted that we would have broader physiological traits, more variance, and more overlap across elevation. So I want to take a step back and just suggest that even though Janssen was talking about temperate and tropical latitudes and seasonality, he's really just making a broader statement about how the distribution of resources within and among populations should predict specialization to those resources. So I could make the same argument and say that the distribution of seed sizes within and among islands in the Galapagos should predict patterns of morphological specialization in beak shape. So in light of that, I'm going to suggest and talk a little bit that we don't need to look across temperate and tropical mountains and across seasons to make predictions and test Janssen's hypothesis. We can do it in a single tropical mountain in the course of a single day. And the reason is that daytime and nighttime thermal variation should recapitulate the patterns that Janssen predicted across seasons. So for example, let's take that mountain again, and now we're going to go from sunrise to sunset. Because of radiation, temperatures should heat up a lot at low and high elevation, and again, maybe not so warm at high elevation, and maybe not so cold at low elevation, but overall, we should recapitulate this pattern. As a result, if we looked at heat tolerance, the trait that should be under selection when temperatures are warmest, we might predict a pattern akin to that Janssen predicted at temperate latitudes across seasons. Conversely, at night, things become cold and, importantly, uniform. So we would expect much less thermal variation from sunset to sunrise, and consequently, we would expect cold tolerance, perhaps to follow the pattern that Janssen predicted for tropical mountains across seasons. This is all well and good, but do the data actually play out this way? So what I'm going to show you now are my own data collected in the Dominican Republic from four sites in the Cordillera Central of the Dominican Republic. Color is going to represent temperatures gathered at four different elevational sites from sea level to about 2,400 meters. Here, time from sun up to sundown is on the x-axis. So here are the data points that I collected. At 45 meters elevation, what you should notice is that there's about 35 degrees Celsius variation throughout a day. That's, from a lizard's perspective, that's pretty substantial. Here are the data for 700 meters. Here are the data for 1,600 meters. Here are the data for 2,450 meters. And what you should see, this already should be conjuring up images of what Janssen predicted across seasons at temperate latitudes. And there's about 30 to 40 degrees Celsius variation. And yeah, not quite as warm at high elevation and not quite as cool, but overall, a lot of overlap. What do we see at night? Well, I'm just going to show you, and this is the pattern that you observe at night. About 5 to 10 degrees Celsius variation at any given site, and importantly, much less overlap, if any at all, in temperature from sundown to sunup. Okay, so our environmental data are consistent. Now let's see if the physiological data match up. So as a reminder, we thought that because there's a lot more thermal structuring at night, we expected physiological specialization in cold tolerance, CT min. And because of the more variable and shared temperatures during the day, we expected a totally different pattern for CT max. So let's find out what happened. In order to do that, I'm going to just talk a little bit about my organisms. So for this study, I focused on anolis lizards from the Caribbean island of Hispaniola. Anoles are a very diverse genus of lizards found throughout the tropical and subtropical regions of the New World. There's about 400 species right now, and more are being described every day. And they are just lovely, charismatic, beautiful organisms to work with. But for this talk, I'll be focusing on my favorite kinds of anoles, LBLs, little brown lizards. these are the civetoid lizards from the island of Hispaniola, and what they lack in blues and greens and orange, they make up for in tons of climatic variability because these lizards are found basically throughout the island of Hispaniola. The highest peak in the Caribbean's here, so we're talking about a lot of topographic and therefore thermal heterogeneity from sea level to high elevations. So as a clade, these lizards are differentially distributed across elevation with some species only found in the lower elevations. That would be Anolis whitemanni and Anolis longitubialis. Two species creep into mid-elevation, about 800 meters, Anolis stromae and Anolis marcanoi. One species is found from sea level all the way up to 1,600 meters. That's Anolis cybodes. And at the highest elevations, it's replaced by two montane endemics, Anolis armori in the western mountains and Anolis shrivi in the eastern mountains. And what I did was, along with my awesome team of field assistants, was scour as many populations as we could and measure heat and cold tolerance, and wherever possible, sample as much of the elevational range across which each species was distributed. So once more, our prediction is the stability and temperature during the night is going to lead to specialization in CT min. So what did we find? Elevation is going to be on the x-axis and CT min on the y-axis. So a lower value of CT min indicates a more cold tolerant lizard. Each point is going to be a population mean with a standard error. And indeed, we found a very strong linear relationship between cold tolerance and elevation, such that the montane lizards were up to about 7 degrees Celsius more cold tolerant than the low elevation lizards. And also there was very little variance, and overall we found a pattern that was consistent with what you'd predict based on Janssen's hypothesis. So once more, we thought the situation for CT max would be different, a lot more thermal variation. We expect broader ranges for CT max and more overlap across elevation. So what did we find? Again, elevation on the x-axis, now CT max on the y-axis, higher values mean more cold, more heat tolerant. And we didn't find that relationship at all. We found much less variance in CT max than CT min, about half as much, and absolutely no relationship with elevation. Whether at sea level or at 2,500 meters, CT max is somewhere between 38 and 40 degrees Celsius. And for, you know, halfway through my PhD, this is sort of like a soul-crushing thing to see, and very depressing. But when things go wrong, it also gets you to think about things more deeply. So I went back to the beginning and thought, well, I've been thinking about how temperature is distributed within and among populations and how this impacts physiology, but there's a major piece of this equation that's missing, and that's behavior. Now, Janssen's hypothesis is essentially agnostic with respect to behavior. He assumed that populations experience the full range of conditions in the habitats where they're found. But we know through thermoregulation that this isn't necessarily the case. So if we were to take a bird's eye view of a thermal habitat, we'd find patches that are too hot, patches that are too cold, and patches that are right in the thermal range where lizards or other ectotherms want to be. So if, let's say, a lizard shuttled randomly throughout its habitat, it would indeed experience the full range of conditions available in that habitat. But with thermoregulation, they can effectively just shuttle between the locations that meet their preferred thermal conditions, and in so doing, experience just a narrower subset of the available environmental temperatures. And in fact, that's exactly what lizards are doing. If you look at body temperature across elevation, it only drops about a degree and a half from sea level to 2450 meters. If they had been passive with regards to their environment, that would have been 10 degrees colder at high elevation. So something's going on. These lizards are definitely behaviorally thermoregulating. So if we put this all together, what we get is Janssen's hypothesis makes very specific predictions, but it assumes that organisms experience the range of conditions in their habitat. If we just extend that hypothesis one step further and include thermoregulation, now we can very cleanly predict the answer that we got in CT max. But we can put this even one step further still. So it may seem pretty obvious to you and I that thermoregulation is a thing, but it's actually only been around as a concept for a little less than a century. It was formalized in 1944 by this gentleman here, Charles Bogert. A few years later, he gave it some more thought and he said, you know what? If organisms can behaviorally buffer themselves from extreme temperatures in their habitat, then their physiological traits should remain static. And if so, then the traits that behavior can buffer should evolve more slowly than the ones it can't. And by his view, behavior could be a constraining influence for evolution. And this idea was later, almost a century later, recoined the Bogert effect. So let's put everything together and now say Janssen's hypothesis and the Bogert effect and say, okay, if so, then the traits that can't be shielded from variation, because there's no, the nighttime temperatures are very stable, there's no behavioral escape from cold temperatures, let's say, then we expect physiological divergence and cold tolerance and a faster rate of evolution. Those traits that behavior can shield from selection, we'd expect less physiological divergence and therefore a slower rate of evolution. And that's exactly what we found. We found that CT min evolves an order of magnitude faster than CT max. And I won't go into the details here, but this is something I've subsequently validated in Australian skinks during my first postdoc. And other studies through indirect measures of evolutionary rate have also validated in other groups of lizards and other ectotherms such as insects. So it may be a generalizable phenomenon. So where are we now? Well, I'd like to argue that we can start thinking about Janssen's hypothesis a bit more broadly and realize that it's really a state of predictions of how variation in some resource within and among populations should impact specialization. Just using Janssen's hypothesis, we're able to very cleanly predict patterns in cold tolerance, but we fail in predicting patterns in heat tolerance. If we just extend the hypothesis a bit more to incorporate behavioral thermal regulation, we're now able to explain patterns of physiological evolution in lineages in this tropical lineage of lizards. And if we include the Bogert effect, we're able to make very clean and testable hypotheses about differences in evolutionary rate. Okay, how am I doing? Oh, I've got time, excellent. Brain break, just a little stretch. Because that was like very data heavy, even I'm tired saying it. Okay, let's move forward. So thus far, we've been talking about behavior as a constraining influence in evolution, that behavior can shield organisms from environmental variation, and as a result, can preclude or limit or slow evolution. But that's only one view on the role of behavior in evolution. There's another view, perhaps the more classical view, which is that behavior drives evolution. So the idea here is that behavior allows organisms to enter new habitats or exploit new resources within their habitat, and in so doing, they're exposed to selection, and this in turn spurs adaptation and speciation. And in fact, Ernst Mayr believed that the prolific diversity of tropical birds, the ones he spent his career studying, was in no small part due to behavioral differences, that birds entered new environments, and this in turn spurred adaptation and speciation. And by no means are these ideas mutually exclusive. They certainly both occur. But what's been interesting is that they've been studied predominantly independently. You gather some data, and you see whether your trait is evolving or not evolving, and make an inference based on that. But what I'd like to propose today is that a single behavior can have both constraining and accelerating influences on evolution in different traits. So here's how this works. So in order to buffer themselves from environmental variation, those lizards are doing something. They have to maybe change when they're active or change how they interact with their habitats. And whatever that shift in resource use is doing can have, as a correlated effect, selection on a different trait unrelated to physiology, because niches are multidimensional, right? So this collection of ideas was theoretically proposed. This is where that Ray Huey paper comes back into play. This is exactly what those authors proposed, that regulatory behaviors require shifts in resource use, and anytime a shift in resource use occurs, that sets up the potential for behavioral drive to also be occurring. And even though these ideas were, you know, synthesized about a decade and a half ago, they really haven't been empirically validated. So that's where this study comes in, what I wanted to test and what I'll be talking about for the second half of the talk. So I wanted to see if behavioral inertia and behavioral drive could occur simultaneously. To do this, I set up a few predictions. I'm going to walk you through them. So these anoles within the adaptive radiation of anoles are trunk ground lizards, which means that they perch on the bottom meter and a half of substrates in their habitat. Consequently, they often perch on boulders and they often perch on trees. That's where they spend most of their time. Now, what if trees and boulders differed in their thermal properties such that one was warmer than the other, and therefore one in a cold environment could confer a thermoregulatory advantage over the other? This would provide that opportunity for a shift in resource use to buffer organisms from selection on physiology, but it may have correlated effects. So that's what I tested. And then if there is a thermoregulatory advantage, do lizards exploit that? Do they change how they use their habitats? Finally, we can draw from the extremely rich literature on the ecomorphological connections in squamates between habitat use and morphology to make very clear directional hypotheses about how any shift in resource use might impact morphological divergence. So in order to do this, I visited high and low elevation sites from both of the main mountain chains in the Dominican Republic. Those are my low elevation sites, and these are the high elevation sites. And I'm going to summarize many, many months of work and labor in three bullet points, which and a lot of methods in three bullet points. So in order to get an estimate of thermoregulation, we really need three pieces of data. We need a null distribution of environmental temperatures in the absence of thermoregulation, what's available to the lizards. We need to know, okay, now that we know that, where do the lizard body temperatures lie? And finally, we need some estimate of their preferred range, like in a laboratory heat gradient in the absence of constraints, where do they want to be? These are the three pieces of data that we needed. So to give you an idea of what these data are going to look like, I've created a fake null distribution of environmental temperatures here. So temperature's on the x-axis, and it's a histogram, so frequency is on the y-axis. If an organism is a thermal conformer, you'd expect a pattern like this where their body temperatures pretty cleanly overlap with environmental temperatures. If, in contrast, you had a distribution of body temperatures in which the range and mean were very different from the environment, then this would be evidence that the lizard is a thermal regulator. So what did we find? I'm going to show you the results for the low elevation sites first. Again, this is a histogram. These are the western mountains over here and the eastern mountains over here. And these were temperatures recorded on boulders and trees over 6 days of sampling at each site. Here are the temperatures on boulders. Here are the temperatures on trees. Here are the temperatures on lizards. Not on lizards. Here are the lizards' temperatures. And what should immediately pop out to you is the very clean overlap in body temperatures and environmental temperatures. So this should already make you think that maybe these lizards are thermal conformers, and you would be right. So if we look, now let's superimpose the preferred range on there. So two things pop out. First, yes, lizards appear to be relatively passive with respect to their thermal environment, but if you look at their preferred temperature, they don't thermoregulate because they don't have to. Their environments fall within their preferred range often. So they can be passive. They don't need to thermoregulate, and they don't. Let's look at high elevation now. So again, the western mountains are going to be here, the eastern mountains here, and 6 days of sampling. Here are the temperatures I measured on boulders. Here are the temperatures I measured on trees. Here are lizard body temperatures. And so this should already stand out to you as these lizards are doing something in their environment. They're thermoregulating. They're not passive with regards to their environment. I also just want to quickly point out that boulders are about 5 degrees Celsius warmer than trees in these sites. So if we superimpose the preferred range on these temperatures, we see that not only do they thermoregulate, but they do so extremely precisely. The ratio ranged from 0 to 1 in both populations. It was 0.93, which is remarkably effective for these lizards. And if we zoom in on that preferred range, I just want to point two things out quickly to you. And the first is that trees are really cold. 95% of the temperatures that I measured on trees were below the lizard's preferred range. So it would be a very bad decision to try to thermoregulate by perching on a tree. In contrast, boulders were 5 times more likely to be within the preferred range of lizards. So consequently, we can infer that there's a thermoregulatory advantage to perching on boulders at high elevation to thermoregulate efficiently. And that's basically what they did. So at low elevation, these lizards exhibit the arboreal niche that's typical of anolis lizards. At high elevation, you see almost a perfect switch to boulders. And this isn't driven by differences in the habitat. Boulders were available at both sites. Trees were available at both sites. This is the lizards capitalizing on a thermoregulatory advantage to perching on boulders. Okay, so we have this awesome result. Yep, some shift in resource use is occurring in these lizards that is buffering them, potentially from selection and physiology. Well, in humans, we are what we eat. In anoles, we are where we perch. So there's some really rich literature documenting some very consistent shifts that occur in boulder-dwelling squamate lineages relative to arboreal ancestors. And one of the most common traits that pops out is dorsoventral compression. You can see immediately the adaptive value of this. It allows them to ease into crevices and cracks more easily. And there is no example so striking as platysaurus, which literally means flat lizard. That's these guys. Another thing that tends to shift in boulder-dwelling lineages is hind limb length. But interestingly enough, this sometimes becomes shorter in some lineages or longer in others. The reason for this may be whether lizards are adapted to climb on boulders or sprint on boulders, but the jury is still somewhat out on this. But we know that limb length tends to change, so we looked at that as well. So basically, Basically, what we did here was gather individuals from the wild, bring them back, and get skeletal measurements from them. I looked at skull and limb dimensions. So for the skull, like I said, head height, skull height. For the hind limb, I looked at femur length, tibia length, metatarsus length, and the length of the fourth toe. I also brought back gravid females from high and low elevation sites, reared their young in the lab to see if any morphological differences detected were environmentally induced or evolved. So what I'm going to show you here are the results, and the wild-caught lizards are going to be here, and the common garden lizards there. And this is a residual plot, so you're going to see the residuals for each of these populations. So a relatively low value would indicate a relatively dorsoventrally compressed skull. And the first finding is that we confirmed our hypothesis. In both the Western and the Eastern Mountains, we found that high elevation lizards had relatively flattened skulls. And this is one of those amazing times when nature, you almost don't need to do the math. This guy is known as the large-headed anole. And if you, it's a common name. It also has more comical nicknames than that. And this is the high elevation lizard, and it's almost like you can see the morphological difference between them. We were able to replicate this same finding in the laboratory rear generation, so we can confirm that these results are not environmentally induced. The second result I'm going to show you is for hind limb length, for the femur, and for the tibia. In both of those cases, we found strong results confirming that in high elevation lizards, hind limbs are shorter, so we had shorter femora and shorter tibiae. And we were able to replicate that again in the common garden experiments. So those differences were also evolved and not environmentally induced. We didn't find any strong differences, however, in metatarsus length or in the fourth toe. Okay. Yes, I'm right on time. So let's bring it all together. We were able to confirm the hypothesis that thermal regulation, behavioral inertia can occur through behavioral drive, that they are not necessarily mutually exclusive processes. In fact, behavioral inertia in this case almost required behavioral drive, and that physiological evolution and morphological evolution can be bridged by common behaviors. This really points out that niches are multidimensional, which I think we sometimes overlook. So when we look at, you know, any traits that are evolving or not, or like piece together these multidimensional patterns of trait evolution, we often forget that they may be connected by the same behavior. And finally, I'd like to point out that without behavior, we might not have made the connection between Janzen's hypothesis and behavioral drive, but somehow we got here. And I think it's a reminder that the way organisms interact with their environments is a really important axis for evolutionary biology. It determines how organisms interact with their environment. And as Ray Huey stated, in order to understand patterns in evolution and the role of behavior in evolution, we must understand the various interacting vectors and tensions that behavior exerts. Those are his words. Finally, I do just want to point out that I'm opening up my lab in Virginia Tech, and I will be looking for motivated people to work with me, and I'm super excited. We're going to be looking at evolutionary ecology, physiology, and morphology, asking, you know, how can organisms respond to climate change, how do we connect patterns between micro and macroevolution, and much more. Finally, I really want to thank the American Society of Naturalists and everyone for being here, and all of my field assistants and collaborators, my advisors, Jonathan Lassus, Craig Moritz, and Sheila Paddock, but especially Jonathan, who's been infinitely generous with his time and ideas, and nothing of this would have happened without him. So thank you all very much.